So who are we? So us three, Kathy Jones and myself, Natasha Barlow, we work for an organization called Birds Canada. And then Kailey is joining us from Ottawa, Ontario. And our main presenter tonight is Kathy Jones. And I'm really excited to be here with her today. She's wonderful and super hardworking and has been a lovely support mentor for us newbies coming in. Kathy's an avid supporter of conservation, habitat stewardship, and biodiversity. And she really cares about each individual and how they can actually make a difference when it comes to tangible conservation actions, which kind of leads us today to the talk about this really fantastic volunteer opportunity in the Great Lakes Marsh Monitoring Program. And so with that, I'll turn it over to Kathy to take it away.
Oh, wow. That's quite an introduction, Natasha. It makes me sound like a wonderful person. Thank you.
You
Welcome,
are.
Everybody. Thank you. It looks like we have about 63 people on board so far. And first, I'm going to apologize for a lot of material I'm throwing at you today. Unfortunately, the Great Lakes Marsh Monitoring Program is a big project. And even if I truncated it into three different talks, it still takes a good 40 minutes to go over this component of it. But to begin today, I'd like to start with a bit of a land acknowledgement. We are tuning in from many locations around the Great Lakes, and we are all situated on Indigenous lands and traditional territories. I myself am located along the north shore of Lake Erie and the Mississauga, Haudenosaunee, Adirondack, and Anishinaabe peoples are the traditional people of the land where I am. We are also in the area of the 1792 Treaty 3, as well as within the District Wanspoon-Wampum area. And I apologize for all the mispronunciations there, I'm learning. For yourselves, to consider which land you're coming from to us from, you can look at the treaty lands and traditional territories in your area at the nativeland.ca website. Kailey will put this link in the chat box, and feel free to share your location with the group on top of your favorite frog. And if you know Ojibwe names or Cree names for frogs, add that as well. We'd love to hear them. I don't know any of them, unfortunately. So on top of that, I'm going to start, poor Kailey is doing a lot of work to begin with. I'm gonna ask you to start a poll about have you heard amphibians at your location yet? This helps me decide how to steer this conversation. I also wanted to mention that we have a door prize and that'll be raffled off about, we'll choose a person about halfway through the talk, and that's a copy of the Marsh Habitat and Vegetation Guide. This is a wonderful little guide. You don't have to have it to do the survey, but it's handy. The problem is it's out of print, and it's not cost effective to reprint. It's available online in the volunteer portal as a PDF, but I have a few handy copies left over, and I will use those as raffle prizes this year. While we're waiting here, Natasha and Kailey, can you hear me okay? Do I need to adjust at all? Okay. And it looks like we have about 81%. And I am probably the person around who does not want spring to come so too quickly. Spring always comes too quickly for me this time of the year. But I know that everybody is in a hurry to get it started. And it looks like we've maxed out there and it slowed down, Kailey, if you want to finalize that poll. And that's great to know. So about 23% of the people attending have already heard frogs. I have heard frogs when I am. Natasha, you're farther north than I. Are you hearing any?
I haven't yet, but honestly, right when we started this, a great blue heron flew in. So it's like, okay, spring is coming. I expect to hear some frogs pretty soon.
They started calling, I think it was, when did I tell you, Kailey? Friday? Thursday or Friday or so they started calling. And now they're getting pretty serious. I suspect the drop down tonight because we're getting hit with freezing rain tonight. But we'll probably hear them again quite loud on the weekend. All right, now let's stop the sharing. Did you share results, Kailey? Or am I supposed to? You did, okay. So I will move away from that. We'll go on to the next one. You guys still seeing the results? Do I have to take it down? So this talk, like I said, is quite long. What I'm hoping to cover is what is a marsh, what is a route, and what is a station? Because you really don't know how to plan your survey unless you understand those three things. We'll go over some route tips and crown checking. We'll go over what exactly is a amphibian call count, which is the bread and butter of this survey, and what frogs are heard, the survey techniques. We're going to spend some time on pitfalls, tips, and data forms, and some time on habitat. Now, like I said, with 40 minutes, I don't have enough time. I set up a sample quiz and a sample example survey for you guys to look at on your own later, and I will make sure you all get those links tomorrow, the next day. I'm going to say the next day just because if what I'm hearing is right and we get rain or ice freezing rain tonight, we could have a fun time getting things out tomorrow. So I'm going to give myself an extra day on that. So let's get started with the getting started manual. So when you start with the survey, and a proportion of you will be new to the survey, and a proportion of you will be getting a refresher. So when you start with the survey, you get the getting started manual, and that's one of the three handbooks for the survey. And when you first get it, tucked into it is a route contact form, a fact sheet that tells you who the regional coordinators are, a fact sheet that shows the route establishment techniques. And on the back side of that is your broadcast unit fact sheet. There is also this year COVID-19 guidance and 8 habitat description forms. Now this first year, you just get a bulk thing. It's just a generic package. In the future years, we customize our package to suit what you survey. But this year we just give everybody the same thing so they can review it all and get the opportunity to learn. Now, I'm not going to spend much time on this, but I wanted to make everybody aware of this document. This is a route establishment fact sheet. And it's basically the same information about setting up a route that is in the getting started manual. Both places work. The difference is this one's in color and it's 4 sheets, and I can email you this when you start surveying or start being interested in a route, and you can learn about the techniques and what you're looking for a marsh. And that gives you a good starting point. Anyone who goes on to a survey site for birds or amphibians should critically evaluate that site, even if you've been doing it for 10 or 20 years, probably particularly if you've been surveying that site for 10 to 20 years. Because marshes change, roads change, quality of the environment changes, safety issues change, and all those things come into play. And I, unfortunately, sitting on my office in Lake Erie, can't tell. So I have to leave it to you guys to tell me whether it's a good site or not. So where do we survey? We do have priorities. For the marsh monitoring program, it's literally marshes, prioritized marshes. We are prioritized first already established routes in marshes. We also want you to survey close to home. And the reason for that is the farther you get away from home, you get more shifts in the microclimates, and you're less likely to be able to sync your schedule and your personal conditions that you see at home with what's happening in your wetland. So the closer you are to this place you survey, the more easy it is for you to get your survey timing right. Now, there are locations where we don't have established routes. And in those situations, any appropriate marsh in a nearby wetland is appropriate to survey. We're not going to ask you to travel an hour for an established route. Find something close to home that matches your life and your schedule. So that's the general idea of it. What else do we look at? Well, what is a marsh? In wetlands in North America, we basically have bogs, fens, marshes, and swamps. We look at marshes. How do we define a marsh? And a marsh is dominated by emergent non-woody plants. So what is an emergent non-woody plant? Now this is detailed in the Getting Started manual. You'll hear me say over and over again that that's your go-to book. Look at those manuals, learn from them. But emergent plants are the green things that stick out of the water, basically. They're not woody, so they're not shrubs and they're not trees. The odd person may think a lily pad is, because at times of the year, they stick out of the water because the water levels are low, but that's really a floating plant. But all those grasses and sedges and arrowhead and purple loosestrife, all those kind of plants are the emergent non-woody plants. Marshes also have open water with floating vegetation. They usually have few trees. The definition of what is a marsh and what isn't is very dependent on the use for that particular wetland that you're defining. But for our purposes, we consider it a marsh if less than 50% of the sampling area is trees or shrubs. So that'll be different from a lot of the other definitions, but that's a fairly easy one to remember. Marshes have standing or slow moving water. If you If you see a lot of rushing water, like in a busy river with a little bit of cacti on the edge, that's not a good place to survey. One, it's not really a marsh. Two, I can just picture the little frogs holding themselves carefully onto those rushing waters and not succeeding at breeding there at all. Marshes are normally periodically or permanently flooded. So you have the big coastal marshes that are always wet, but you also have little hay meadows and places like that that may be only flooded in the spring or once every few years. So what else to consider? That's not it. Like I said, you guys are the ones there that have the critical eye. So you also want to keep in mind visibility. Can you see? Less important with amphibians, as long as you can get there, because you can hear, because it's all auditory calls. What are the noise level like? Will they impact your ability to survey? Do you feel safe getting into that site? Do you feel safe at that site? And that comes with people safety, trail safety, water safety, all those things have to be come into play. Is it ease of access? Some of us don't mind trudging through 2 kilometers in the dark in the woods. Other ones that want something fairly close to the road, and those are the decisions only you can make. Also for birds, we look at the time of day. When I think of that, birds can be surveyed either early in the morning or late in the evening. So for example, if you are, your station faces east, perhaps evening surveys are better. If your station is placed near evening traffic zones, maybe morning surveys are better. That's the kind of logistics that you have to think about. And the first year, it's more difficult. You often say after your first year, hold it, something's weird here. And you think about it and you come up with a better plan. And then you have a chat with me about it. So what is a route? Well, a route is basically the management term that we use for this survey. And it is a series of stations put together that you can survey in a single evening. Now, there's 2 classic examples of a route for the Marsh Monitoring Program. The one on the route 1 is a classic for large coastal marshes. All your stations are lined up in a row. Every one is surveyed for birds. Every other one is surveyed for amphibians. Route 2 example is more what you see in areas of concern where there's been a lot of habitat degradation in urban areas or inland. So you have little marshes and you get 1 or 2 stations in each little marsh. Now, don't be surprised if you only have 1 station to survey, because that's all the marsh that's available. That's quite common. So what is a station? A station is your sampling point, it's a sampling area. And normally I do this in person and you can see me waving my hands around. I don't know what all you're going to see this time. But a station area is 100 meters semicircle. And so if you've envisioned a segment of orange, and you go out forward 100 meters or 110 yards, and you go left and right 110 yards, and you go up 100 meters or 110 yards. You have this segment, this wedge, and that's basically your surveying sampling area. And that's where you're predominantly collecting your data. You're going to learn very shortly, it's not completely, but that's a predominant area we're looking at to survey. So you know that you have stations, you know your stations are along the routes. How do you set them up? The biggest thing we want to achieve when we set up our routes is not to overlap broadcast calls for birds, which is not something we're going to spend a lot of time talking about today, and not to overlap where you hear amphibians. Amphibians calls carry a lot. So we want our amphibian stations 500 meters apart. Let me just go back here, 550 yards. And that helps prevent you hearing the same frogs at the 2 stations. Now for birds, to give you an idea how that works, they can be close together. They could be 250 meters apart, 275 yards. So you don't necessarily have your bird surveys at the same place as your amphibian surveys. And then there's another feature where you can only have a frog survey and only a bird survey. So some spots might be only birds because they're too close for another amphibian surveys. And in some situations, you may have 2 frog surveys back to back because it's what we call a, because we're not using any broadcasts, we're just listening for the frog surveys. You can readily do 1 survey facing 1 direction and turn around and do another survey facing the other direction. That you can't for birds. And the reason is, because the broadcast that you travels the whole circle. Now, right now, we don't really need to know about birds, but it's kind of nice to have the skill set when you're out there looking at your route and figuring out what's going on. So if you guys have questions so far, please put them down in the Q&A. Natasha and Kenny are going to keep track of such things, and we'll answer them all as much as possible at the end. What we don't answer, I'll add in a fact sheet from later and share it with you. But moving on, I'm showing you now the route contact form. Now, this is the first form you get in the package, and I'm not spending a lot of time on these forms. I just want to point out, this tells us who you are when you return your data. It also tells us who you survey, where you survey. And the biggest take home with this form today is that if you are setting up a new route or if you're changing your route, you need to complete section B and C when you return the data. Now, B is the bottom of the first page, and C is the back page. And on C is where you list all your stations and you tell us, oh, this one's no good, it's time to retire it. I want to replace it with this station. It's a new one called H and so forth. And that's where you share the information so we can process your data and put it into the system. So I promise you, that's all I'm doing for routes tonight. It's a lot and it's quick. There's lots in the Getting Started manual, so read it over carefully. Most of you have existing routes or have been in the program, so it should be easier for you to sort that out. Oh, one final thing, I lied. One final thing is, how do you give us coordinates? There's a lot of ways anymore. You can send us a map. You can produce a Google map and get the coordinates off of that. And if Kaylee's unable to share that YouTube link, and I don't think she can, I will share it later. You can get an app on your phone, or a compass app on your phone. And it's actually, those things work quite well. And you can grab the latitude and longitude off of that. Or you can use the more traditional method of all things and use actual GPS in the field. So the biggest thing to keep in mind, if you're sending us coordinates, we want to know where you're standing within reason, like 20 or 30, 40 or 50 feet from that point. But we need to know where you're standing to ensure that our information is accurate on the site. So now on to the next section. I'm doing the boring stuff first, and then I promise you we have frog calls to follow. And that is vegetation. Nobody likes to do habitat surveys. Everybody likes to survey birds and amphibians. The thing is, we need to know what habitat these critters are in. So we have a very simple multiple choice habitat form, and we ask you to fill it out once a year, even if you think nothing has changed. It should take no more than 1 to 2 minutes per station. Now, it's best done between late May and mid-June. And the reason for that is you want the vegetation to flush up enough that it's green and you can tell what it is. But if you're vertically challenged at all, like myself or Tara in this picture, you don't want the vegetation too high that you can't see over it. I get a lot of people every year tell me, well, I left my survey too late. I couldn't get the habitat done because the plants were too high. So that's something to keep in mind. We recommend for bird surveyors, it's best at the first visit. And you don't have to do that yourself for birds. You can drag along a partner and they can do it while you do your bird survey. For frog surveys, it's usually done around the second visit. That you'll have to do during the day. I've not found a way where you can do a good habitat survey yet at night. And basically what you do is you stand at the focal point of your survey station and you estimate coverage. And before you get too worried about having to do habitat, there's a whole bunch in the Getting Started manual to help you. We also send you on the back of the habitat forms definitions to help you follow through. We don't leave you out there alone. You don't have to drag the big book if you don't want to. And those will walk you through this multiple choice form. There's two areas that can be tricky. Well, first off, the photo at the back, the sketch at the back. We don't expect an artist rendition. The biggest purpose for this is so that it gives us a double check against the other information you provide. And this is actually a fairly good sketch. It doesn't have to be this good. It's optional. You don't have to do it. I like doing it because when I sit there and draw my habitat on my little 100 meter form, it helps center me in and helps me decide what's there and I can answer the questions better. Next is this area up here. Most of this is multiple choice. But this area here is percent of major habitats in 100 meter radius of the station area. So that's looking at your sampling area, and you're just telling us what proportion of that sampling area is trees, what proportion is emergent vegetation, what proportion is water, and so forth. And it should add up to 100 because it's 100% of the area that you're given. The next section is this area here, and that's dominant emergent vegetation. And people get a little confused about this one. Dominant emergent vegetation is, again, those things that stick out of the water that are green, that are not woody. And there's better explanation than that in the materials that we sent you, I promise you. And basically, we want to have the four most dominant emergent vegetations in your site. So look at your sampling point when you do this and remove everything else. And just think about the emergent vegetation. What's the most common emergent vegetation in that area? In this example, it's cacti. How much cacti? We think there's about 50%. Okay, what's the next most dominant one? What else is the next most common? Grasses and grass-like sedges. We think about 20% of the land cover in that sampling area of emergent vegetation is grasses and grass-like sedges. So we put down 20%. We also see a lot of rushes, and we also see a lot of pickle. Weed, less than the grasses for both, but still a fair bit. We're estimating 10 of each. Now that tallies up to 90%. And that's okay, because there's quite honestly a few little plants in there that belong to other species, but they're not dominant, because dominants are 10%. And you don't have to have four of them either. Like, you may have something that's a cactail monoculture that you just have cactails. And that's as difficult as that particular form gets. And there, we're done the habitat, and we can move on to what everybody's here to learn, which is frogs. Once I figure out how to get rid of my laser pointer and move on. Frogs, as I said, if you have questions, feel free to ask, put them in the Q&A, and we will cover them as soon as we can. So frogs, how does the frog survey work, and what do you do and when do you do it? Frog surveys are 3 visits a year, and they are about 15 days apart. They're scheduled from early April to mid-June, but the timing of the surveys is latitudinally and climatically dependent on your area, and I will go over that a little bit more. So it's very dependent on temperature, and that's something we will go over. They start half an hour after sunset through midnight. They have to be in the dark. You want little or no wind, and little or no precipitation. So I hear right now people saying in the back of my head, frogs like water, frogs like rain. They do like rain, but you'll find that the calls decrease if it's heavy rain because of the thin skin. So they'll stop calling. And wind, not only can't you hear in wind, or you don't hear proportionately equally, in wind, it dries out their skin. So again, they will stop calling. It's also a 3-minute survey. So what does that mean? Well, you go out, what I like to do is I walk up to my very farthest station from the mainland, and I wait till after dark, usually have a snack while I'm waiting. Then I trudge back a little bit to my first station. I give it about a minute to calm down. If you're really, really noisy, you give it a little bit more than a minute. If you're in a boat or something like that, it's quite noisy. You give it a good few minutes until things calm down and the frogs start calling again. Then you click your timer and you take a 3-minute survey. And then when you're done the 3 minutes, you move on to the next station. And we'll go over the forms very quickly later. So what is it about temperature? Temperature is often more important than the date. Like, 27% of us have already heard frogs calling in our areas already, and I am one of them. I don't think it's quite yet time to survey in my region. It's still fairly cold, but it's getting very close. So you want to have, for your first visit, at least greater than 5 degrees Celsius. And ideally, it's been after a little bit of nice warm rain. I myself, I'm usually in a winter hat and mittens when I do my first survey. And then for visit 2, it's greater than 10 degrees, visit 3, greater than 17 degrees. So the survey provides these magic dates when, depending on your region, whether you're south, which is below 43 degrees latitude, central, which is in between 43 and 47th latitude, or north above 47th, those are estimated times to survey. And sometimes they're right on, but other times you have to trust the weather more carefully. So I say this, survey on the first appropriate night that fits your schedule. And I also mentioned that if you're new and you're starting late, you're gonna have a hard time meeting that this year. You've got a large learning curve. Don't get too concerned about that. Try to get that first survey in to figure it out and try to better time your second and third survey. Next year, you can polish up the schedule to make it fit better. So how do we do this technique? The technique that we use is called the calling code index. And it's based on male territoriality during breeding. So all little male amphibians and frogs and toads want to space themselves out in the marsh to make them look like they're the best frog out there. And they want the calls to be differentiated from the competitors. But as the number of frogs increase in that pond and in that area, the calls begin to overlap. So a chorus, which is something that you'll hear a lot from me, a chorus is a group of frogs that call, group of toads that call. And you have little choruses of frogs throughout your survey area. And this makes more sense in the field when you have stereo, when you have distance and direction to work with. Now a code one means that you can hear every single frog and you can count them. There's no call overlap. A code two, there is some call overlap. You may not be able to identify every frog that's calling, but you can estimate the number of individuals. A code three is just a huge blur of sound. You can't tell which frog is which, you just know there's a lot of them. And that's a basic survey technique. Now, we don't leave you hanging with only that much knowledge. We provide a lot of tools. And I call this a training CD. It was originally a cassette tape. Now it's an MP3 file. But I wanted to point a few features out on this, and it's available on the website, and you have an introduction for amphibians. And down here, you're going to have a whole bunch of stuff that help explains how the calling system works. And this is important, and this MP3 files combined with the amphibian manual will teach you this program. You can do this program without any other knowledge and learn how to do it. Testing it out this year, we have a SoundCloud podcast as well. I'm not quite sure if it makes it a podcast or not, but we have SoundCloud files. If you don't like using the downloads of the MP3s, that you can try instead. So moving on. Next, at poll, so everybody can catch their breath. So here's a question, we're about to do training calls. Which frog sounds like a banjo? Is it the mink frog, the Blanchard's Creek frog, the green frog, or the gray tree frog? I'm supposed to remind you that you can put your questions in the Q&A here. And somebody liked Kermit, didn't they? Yes, we have a Kermit here. And those training MP3 files are available online through the volunteer portal. You might want to sign in first. And you look up training CD, I think it's still called. We also have a zipped version as well. So you can download the whole zipped file if you'd like to. And the SoundCloud. It's a little funkier with Apple products because Apple's got a greater security level. But it's pretty good. So we're still building up. Are we done here? It looks like we're finished off. And we have a lot of, do you want to end that poll, Kailey? So it looks like most people picked green frog, which is spelled wrong, but they still got it. That's terrific, because that is what sounds like a banjo. So we can stop sharing and we'll go over and we'll do the frog call IDs now. Let me just get out of my highlighter. And as I said, we're running a little bit later than the 30 minutes, but I think you guys all want to hear the frog calls. So I should have mentioned this earlier. You get a book to help you do this. And tucked into your book is your amphibian summary sheet and your three amphibian data forms. Those are set up for large marshes. If you have a small marsh, in future years, you're going to get a smaller data set. Okay, so let's quickly run through these frogs, even though you're running late, because I know you all want to hear this. We're going to start with the wood frog, which sounds a lot like a duck quacking in the distance. Oop. You may want to adjust your volume. That could be too loud, too small, low. Now, I should mention the first three frogs, coarse frogs, wood duck, wood frog, and spring peeper, are what we call explosive breeders. They mostly breed in vernal pools, and so they all breed at once to take advantage of those early spring waters, and then they're gone. So they breed quite quickly. And the coarse frogs are what I'm hearing in my backyard right now, and they sound like a thumb running over a comb. Next is a spring peeper, and you're going to hear this in every time you go in the wetland. It's a single high-pitched peep repeating every second. Oop. I can just get it to play. And you'll hear that particular frog calling in every other MP3 file I play tonight. Next, we're getting a little bit later in the season. The northern leopard frog is a frog that you often find in the grass, and it sounds like a snore with a chuckle on the end. And a lot of people describe the chuckle as a rubbing your hands on a wet balloon. Keep in mind, early in the season, these guys will call during the day, and they often truncate, and you don't hear that chuckle at the end. American toad is next. This is your garden toad. And it is a long drawn out non-musical trill lasting 30 seconds. So just by listening to that, you can understand that code threes differ between species. Like the American toad code three, that is all you can't count in, is far fewer calls than, say, a gray tree frog code three with a shorter call that's easier to differentiate individuals. Speaking of which, here's your gray tree frog. This is the only frog we have that changes colors in our area. Sounds a lot like a bird. Usually the birds are flying though, and they usually don't stay in one spot, and they're usually in the daytime. Now, green frog, which so many people got right, as the banjo frog, as I like to call them, is a gunk or boink, very similar to plucking the strings of a banjo. This is one of our deep water frogs. It's one of the two frogs in our area that overwinters as tadpoles. Now, one thing I like about that call is starting to get call that you heard there is starting to get a bit of a rhythm. It's easy to start thinking this is a bullfrog because it's got a touch of rhythm. But once you hear the bullfrog, you'll never differentiate the two because these guys, this is our biggest frog. And again, overwintering as a tadpole. It's got such a deep bass and rhythm. This is the frog of my childhood. I used to hear these behind my home when I was a child, and I still remember the call to the day. Oops. Got to play it now. All right, so those are all the calls I'm going to play. I'm going to just show these guys. These are less common frogs. Mink frog is more north and west. Pickerel frog likes cold water streams. Maybe I'll play that one because it's easy to misidentify the northern leopard frog and the pickerel frog. The northern leopard frog is a snore with a chuckle. And the pickerel frog is shorter. I almost call it a sneer. And when you hear that a cold northern leopard frog, and you might misidentify the two, if you're questioning the location as having pickerel frogs because it's not cold water stream, take a listen, go back home and take a listen to the two calls and compare them. So you see it's a lot shorter. Fowler's toad are more of a Lake Erie a sand dune species. It's a species at risk. Blanchard's cricket frog is a tale of caution. In Ontario, it's been extirpated for many years. It's still found in some areas of the survey range in the US. So that's it for frogs. We're going to quickly go over this sample, and I'm not spending a lot of time on it. we're already running late. I will sending you a sample of this that you can go over yourself and learn on your own. The biggest thing to keep in mind is that you want to tell us who you are. And this is the in-field form. You want to tell us when you're surveying and what direction you're facing. And for every little chorus that you hear in front of you in your 3-minute count, you put down the calling code, like here's for spring peepers. We have a calling code of 2 and a calling code of 3. And for the smaller calling codes, code 1 and code 2, you put down the number of frogs calling. And the example goes over this carefully, and you'll learn well from the example that I have online that I'm going to share with you. And then because the frog survey is unlimited distance technique, that means any frog you hear in front of you, like in that 100 meter circle and way beyond facing forward, you report. So you may think it's in the next pond over, but if it's still in front of you, you put it down. The thing we need to do though, is I showed you those amphibian habitat forms that they're connected to the 100 meter area. So we identify if the species is present inside 100 meters or outside 100 meters, so that we can use the information for habitat modeling. We want to keep track of all the frogs, but we want to know if that species is using within the 100 meter range. And that's about it. What else do I need to share with you? Always include the code. Use the count or the estimate of the number of frogs calling, the codes 1 and 2. Don't count the frogs behind you. There will always be more calling behind you. It's the way it works. And be careful. You may get the odd bird upset that's calling at the same time. So be aware of that. All right. And then you take the same information. And I'll go over this incredibly quickly. And you transfer it to your data form. So you put down the highest calling code for that species. And if it's not code 3, you tell us the total number of frogs you just heard, and you let us know if there was any of those species within 100 meters. And you continue through and you do that for all the other frogs you hear. You'll notice that whether they're in or out, we are still reporting them, whether they're in, whether they're out, they still get counted and put down. And that's a very, very fast version of the technique. And there is an example that I will share with you that'll explain it in detail. So one more poll, and it's 41 minutes, so I'm sorry, I'm running late. And then we're gonna switch over to questions very soon. What is the most common reason why visits are missed or poorly timed? Could it be not checking the run in advance and discovering issues? Trusting the visit dates to work in your area, waiting for perfect conditions, weather conditions, or leaving it too late. And we'll see what people say. I trust the volunteers who have already been surveying on this. I really don't have a good answer for you. These are all problems to be aware of and to see. And I think there's been several people who've heard me talk before, because I suspect we're going to hear what I think the most common problem is. But we'll wait and see what the answers is. And as I said, add it to the Q&A. We're almost done. And my apologies, we may go over a bit too long to answer the questions. Do we have a lot of questions, Natasha?
We have 6 questions.
That's enough.
So they'll be very exciting.
So it looks like I see a lot of what I tell people all the time, which is waiting for perfect conditions. And I think that's literally it. If you wait for the best night to survey, you're going to miss it. You survey on the first night that's appropriate for the schedule. And don't try. And maybe that schedule is yours, not the frogs. So if the conditions are right and it matches your schedule, go out there and survey. I tend to keep everything prepared, boots near the door. And when I hear frogs at home, then I go. And I find that's the best way of making the schedule. All right, so I'm going to close it out. And life happens. Survey on the first appropriate date that matches your schedule. Just wanted to reiterate, you get a lot of materials. You've all got your kits. There's materials in the volunteer portal, including a PDF of the Marsh Habitat and Vegetation Guide. Kailey, did you take the raffle numbers already? Okay, well then we'll get to that in a minute. The volunteer portal is a great place and it's off the main website. Biggest thing to remember is your name has got to show up for you to see everything. If you have not logged in, you're not going to see all the information available on that site. Including, now, final thing I wanted to go over is safety. I can't undervalue, it's important to keep yourself safe out there because I'm not out there with you. I trust you guys to do what's best for you. So a quick idea of what's wrong with my friend here in this picture and what's right. Wrong, she's out in a canoe at night. Does she have lights? Does she have a strobe on her vest just in case she falls in? Does she have the appropriate safety and legal equipment for boating at night? Can she be seen by others? Now, what she is doing right is she is sitting down. She's not standing up in the boat, which a lot of people like to do because they can see better, especially with the bird surveys. And she has a life jacket on. So just remember to critically think what you're doing and make sure you're safe. Volunteer safety, you want to make sure it's accessible in daytime and at night. If there is a reputation of being a bad place to go because it's unsafe, let me know. I don't want you surveying in unsafe places. We're going to retire that site. Make sure you have the right safety gear. Have a partner. I can't undervalue that. Road routes, boat routes. Can other people see you as much as you can see them? Make sure that you have bright colors. Take traffic into consideration. Park in a logical and safe spot. Boats follow the laws of the marine laws, life jackets, bailers, lights. Above all else, if by any chance you don't feel you should be out there that night, don't survey. Another day will come. By the way, all that information is on the back of every handbook and you can review the safety information there. Returning data. You want to limit your paperwork. Use of MMP forms in the field. I don't mind bugs. I don't mind coffee stains. I don't mind a little bit of DEET. We can handle it all. Don't use a field book and transfer. One, it will be standard. You will miss something. I can guarantee it. And it's just another level of paper you have to do. Let me know who you are. If you don't know your identifiers, write in enough information that I can figure it out. Photocopy and keep a scan of it prior to returning it. Guaranteed somebody's data will get lost in the mail every year. It happens every year. And that's very frustrating if you don't have that backup piece. Send us your original by July 31st. Please do not email me your data to my already overflowing mailbox because we can't really scan it afterwards. And there's a lot of stuff that goes into that mailbox. Can't do this alone. So I want to thank not only all our partners and all our watershed partners, but every single volunteer who's helped with this program. Because without it, we couldn't do this project. And that's it. I'm going to go off, stop sharing here so we can see each other. Kailey, do we have somebody to win a prize from?
Yes, so I just drawed randomly and the name was Kira or Kyra McKenna. I will post it in chat in a second.
Cool. Kyra, can you please make sure we have your address? You can email it to me if you don't want me to put it on the chat or just chat, put in the chat right to Kailey. And we'll make sure that you get your prize package, which will be a habitat guide and a couple stickers and a few other things from Birds Canada. We will also do one more prize, and that'll be for completing the survey link that is sent to you about the survey, and we'll pick a random number from all the people who return that survey who provide us emails, and we'll give you a prize to someone for that as well. I have talked very fast and covered a lot, and I'm sure I've overwhelmed everyone, but maybe there's some questions I can help make it easier for people for. Natasha, what do we have?
Yeah, so questions a lot about different survey protocols. So what if the marsh is really dense and the water is further out than 100 meters? I'm assuming they're asking if that's still a survivable marsh.
Absolutely. Survival. Remember the technique, it was periodically or permanently wet. So especially with Great Lake water level changes, like the site that was wet 3 years ago won't be wet in many places now, but it's still a marsh. And you will find a dramatic difference in amphibians, but this is a long-term survey. We're looking at information through time. So we need all, even with all those years differences in conditions, in the long run, the data will show what's going on.
Great. And another question, just kind of in your the same tone about marshes. What is considered like tiny, small, like what kind of size of marsh and how do you determine that? Because the word that sounds relatively subjective based on each surveyor.
Yes, no. We need to have a spot that holds a sampling station. So you need to fit that 100 meters radius, 110 yard radius semicircle into your wetland. That's a single station. And that station has to hold predominantly marsh. It's got to have 50% or less trees and shrubs. And that's explaining the getting started protocol, what we're asking for. And that's where you look at that or the route establishment fact sheet. Now, granted, there are some people who have perhaps not the best tools to identify that. And it shows up on my desk and I'm sitting there, ooh, this has got 75% woody. And I will tell them that that has to be retired and then find another spot. In urban settings where we're trying to figure out marsh activity when there's incredibly limited marshes available, we will stretch those rules. And we hope to get at least 50% of the station being marsh. And the rest can be other landscapes. But the ideal is that about the size of a football field, about the size of a baseball diamond with the outfield, that's the kind of a size we're looking at for single station.
Perfect. And so any advice on differentiating frogs inside that 100 meter and outside that 100 meter buffer?
I think once you get that, you're going to me, it's more of a measure of close and not close. I honestly feel that once you're in the field and trying it, it won't be near as difficult as you think, just because you have stereo and you have distance and relative time. And one thing I do recommend when you're setting up your wetland and try to evaluate in your brain how much 100 meters is, and there's a couple ways to do this. There's modern apps and pedometers and fitness trackers and everything else. Somehow measure out 100 meters or 110 yards and look back and see what that distance is. And that will help give you a visual parameter. I have said in the past, you can mark that out on your marsh, on your sites for when you do your bird, your habitat, and just to see what's going on. I question that behavior now because there's so many people on wetlands, they really don't want to see a forest of flagging tape, and especially plastic, non-degrading flagging tape. So you're better off just to visually estimate before you go out, figure out what the distance is, and try to remember that as you survey.
I also found it helpful with birds too, just if you have someone like just to help you, like basically stand at those different like distance bands. That's what I use for practice, but I know that's very different for different species.
But it's so much easier now. Like we all have Fitbits and this, that, and the other, and they tell us how many meters we've gone. And phones, you can use your Google Maps and your phone when you're walking, and it'll tell you when you've gone 100 meters. There's a lot more options to figure this out than the old fashioned pacing that we started with. I won't say how long ago.
All right, a couple clarifying questions. Okay. Did you say it is okay to survey up to 40 to 50 feet away from the established coordinates without changing those coordinates officially?
That's getting stretched. I would rather see 20 to 30. I guess what I would like to see is that mapped in such a way so I know it's the same sampling area. Like if you move 50, if your station, for example, was facing northwest and you move 50 feet meters around a curve and now you're just facing, say, north, it'd probably be the same area. So I think it's very dependent on the station layout. And I would probably want to look at it in a map to decide that. I would certainly try it and say, Kathy, I think the station has to be moved. This is where I put it. Can you tell me if this is a new station or the same? And I can figure that out if you give me the point coordinates for it. There's sometimes you have to, right? Sometimes conditions just force you to move your station.
And another clarifying question. Do you do your first survey if it's 6 Celsius, but a wind chill of 2 Celsius?
Probably not. They'd like warm. And if you have a wind chill, well, first off, I didn't mention it, but you have to have a wind below a Beaufort level 3. And I'm thinking if it's a wind chill that takes it down about 5-6 degrees, that's more than a Beaufort level 3. So my first thought would be no, but I would have to listen and see how the day's playing out at that time.
Yeah. I think a lot of these clarifying questions you said will be in the like document that gets sent to all the volunteers as well. There'll be a lot of links in there as well.
And the getting started has a lot. And a lot of that is just getting to your site and deciding if it works. Like if you're in a site that's low in a valley and protected from the winds, maybe it's a good choice. But if you're in a highly exposed coastal wetland, I would say no, you're not going to get anything that night.
And also kind of on the same idea of, you know, going to your site, there's a question that when an individual reviewed their route, they realized that it's much more windy at that route than, you know, 10 minutes away at their house. And so is there really a good way to know how windy it will be without physically visiting? And I think that's kind of the beauty of field work is beauty in the chaos of field work is really just not knowing.
It is, but there is, oh, what's it called? Our colleague Gregor Beck has this. It's called online network of home weather systems. And I'm trying to think what it's called and I can't. I will try to come up with it and put it in the stuff I send tomorrow. And what you can do, it depends, of course, if it's in your area, it's weather ground, weather underground or something like this. You might find a station that's right near where you survey that you can check what the wind speed are. But you'll also learn that some days it's just trial and error. I remember I used to live an hour from my survey station, and my father lived right next to it. So I would call him before I come down every night and call and ask. But not everybody has that luxury of having the family right there.
I do remember weather underground. I just put in the chat, not endorsement. I'm not entirely sure how well that's going to work, but I know it has worked in the past. So nice mention of that. Kind of on the topic of weather, how do you know which temperature region you are in? Is that something that's in the manual?
Yes, it is. I also, if you look at the coordinates for your, it's based on your first stop on your list. So if it's less than 43 degrees, you're in south. If it's in between, if that first station is at a latitude between 43 degrees and 47, it's central. And if it's above 47, it's northern. For Ontario, because I can visually see Ontario, I'm not as good as Michigan, that splits out just south of the Lake Ontario and crosses over. That's where 43 degrees is. 47 degrees is just north of Sault Ste. Marie. So, but there is graphics in the manual about that.
Another question, there's 3 left in the Q&A, so I think we can get through those. My stations are accessible via kayak. In some spots, the marsh has grown in and the coordinates are slightly different. Will I record my exact position in the water?
The ideal is to get as close to that spot as possible. With marshes, it's always tricky because marshes move, especially those big ones. Try to get as close as possible. If you think it's a 1-year thing and it's only a few meters, don't worry about it. But it's a big shift. Send me the coordinates and we'll review it. But don't not survey because marshes change and it makes it tough. I should mention that the whole reason behind that point of having to be in the same location, which we've really ramped up the importance of that in the last decade or so, relates to the analysis. And the way the analysis are done, statistically, they're identified to a spot on the Earth. And the idea is you have one code for one spot on the Earth, and that does not move. So if you move your spot that you're surveying from, it's got to get a new identifier. So that's the logic behind that. It's why we're so careful with those coordinates nowadays.
More questions in the Q&A. Must there be 8 stations?
Absolutely not. It's decided more so on your wetland. Like if your wetland only holds one or two, so be it. Or if your whole wetland only holds two birds and one amphibian, you don't have a choice. You've got three stations or two stations, one for amphibians. It also is dependent on your time. If it's a route that requires a lot of logistics between stations, you're gonna have fewer stops. And the whole identifying of what is a route is based on, you can survey it in one evening or morning period, depending if it's birds or amphibians. And what else am I out here? I'm missing something. That's the biggest one. You can survey it all at once in one shot is the big one for you. And it's limited by the amount of wetland available. That's the other one I need to say.
All right, and last one, and I think this is just a question based on what was on the screen. Someone's wondering what BSTN1 and ASTON1 mean. I think it was earlier in the presentation, whether it's species codes or...
BSTN would be bird station. ASTN is amphibian station.
Perfect, there you go.
And you'll notice if you're new to the program, when you get your route, sometimes I forget to replace it. I'm trying to remember to replace it. We have A stations, B stations, and AB stations. A stations are surveyed for amphibians. B stations are surveyed for birds. AB are surveyed for both. I'm trying to replace that with just birds and frogs and frogs and birds. But that's the way it's coded in our data system.
Perfect. Well, that's everything in the Q&A. I did see some other additional in the chat. Someone on Facebook chat was asking for the website. So again, a lot of this information will be sent in the document post-webinar or on the website, the Great Lakes Monitoring, Marsh Monitoring Program.
Should I drop the website on the Facebook? I probably should.
Yeah, or even if you just like screen share with just like the websites, or I can... we can just type it in the chat both times again, just to make sure everyone has that covered. Yeah.
It is several times, I think, within the webinar. I try to repeat it a lot. The basic website for go to is birdscanada.org/GL_MMP. And from there, you'll have the newsletter and our latest two reports, and you'll have access to the volunteer portal. And for the volunteers, the volunteer portal, has everything you need in it. Now, I should mention, we have a lot of people on this talk tonight who, thanks Kailey, who are still trying to decide if they want to become involved, which is fair. This is a big project. It's not a decision to be made lightly. To register, you go to that main website, www.birdscanada.org/GL_MMP, and you can look at the route map. And then what you do next is you go to request a survey route. And whether you know exactly whether you want a survey that's available or not, use that, because that gets you into the queue when I get you all the information, your kit, your maps, everything else is run off of that. And I have all the information as well as the privacy rights to contact you. So that's the best way to get started with the program. Okay. So what are we at time-wise? Oh, my Lord, we're almost on time. That's strange, considering how much I talked, and I apologize for going so fast. Do we have any other questions? Kailey, did you see any questions we haven't caught?
So there was a couple extra in chat. I think you kind of mentioned them through, answered them already through the other questions, but someone did mention wanting some sort of practice session. I just wondered if you wanted to mention you having, I think you had some practice quiz and material, if you wanted to mention that.
Yeah, I'll mention that again. There's a couple things. When you look at your guide, the Amphibian Handbook, there's a really nice example in it that goes over the techniques well. There is a mistake in it, and I'd love to see how many people pick up the mistake. Being one of the authors, I know the mistake. But when I send you the fact sheet either tomorrow or the next day, depending on the weather, it will have in it a PowerPoint presentation that you can click through for an amphibian quiz to help see how well you know your amphibians, as well as another one that's an example form and example survey for a single station. They're not perfect and they're small, but they will help get you thinking about doing the survey. And if those don't work for you, I threw them both into a YouTube presentation as well, but frankly, I think the clickable versions work better for learning. And, but you do have to download it onto your computer to make it work. So if you only have a phone or something like that, try the YouTube versions and just stop them once in a while as you learn until you get it figured out. Anything else, Kailey?
I don't think so. It's everything I have for chat.
I just saw a few more come in the Q&A if people want to stick around for that. Someone's wondering if you can survey on Indigenous territories.
You can survey on Indigenous territories with the appropriate, what's the word I want here, Natasha? With the appropriate guidance and permissions of the nation that holds that land.
Yeah, I think it's very much dependent on like the relationship and not so much like, here, we're doing this, let us in, you know, like it's very much that, you know, relationship building and a mutual, you know, an agreement and understanding of how this benefits everyone.
Definitely, if you're a member of that community, reach out. We'd love to get the surveys done. But if not, that's something you will have to have a conversation with us and have a conversation with the nation to get going.
The last question in the Q&A is, they downloaded the MP3 files, but wondering if there's a picture of the species to go with. And I know on Dendroika, which will be sent out there, you can make your own quizzes, especially for birds, that quizzes you on the sound and also for the pictures. So I'm wondering specifically if you have anything on that.
I don't rely too much on amphibian pictures. And it took me a long time to learn what the frogs look like. And that's because it's all done by call. But included in the information that I will share is links to the Adopt-A-Bound program in Ontario and Frog Watch Canada. I should find, maybe I will find Frog Watch USA to pop in there. And the reason for sending those three is if you decide that perhaps you want to also survey the backyard, which is just a pond, that's a great place to put the data. But also they all have another great option for learning calls and for looking at what the frogs look like. And trying different places is a great idea. You'll also notice that I recommend USGS, I'm gonna go with the USGS service, frog quiz, because it's exceptional. They have hundreds upon hundreds of frog calls, and it's a great random quiz to help you learn your skills. I have not managed to get 100% on it yet. I usually aim for about 85 I get. You need good speakers. You want to choose the Ontario quiz, whether you're in Ontario or not, and that is because it is a Great Lakes watershed quiz.
Perfect. Well, that is mostly everything. I was just going to type in the chat, but if we're here, they're wondering if there are any others surveying in the Turkey Point Marsh. They don't want to overlap, and I'm assuming they can just reach out.
There is no overlap at this point. Turkey Point, that'll be Stacy. Sorry to call you out there, Stacy. Doug says that there may be some Environment Canada worked on this year. Environment Canada has their own set of surveys that they do every 5 years, and it's a slightly different technique. Don't worry about overlapping. Chances are they will do it at a different time of day, and they'll so I don't see it being a problem. And both Doug and I have discussed it several times, and we prefer to see both surveys run because we want to see that annual information, not just the for periodical. And quite frankly, we're not sure which year CWS is in there. But they would have to go through the same permissions for that marsh, because that's a privately owned marsh as anybody will. Nobody's going to be surveying in that particular marsh without permissions, which I should mention. If it's private owned land, people need to get permissions and permits to go into it. That's a point that I don't say often enough.
Well, that's it for all the questions. Thanks everyone sticking around.
Yes, thank you. And we're almost on time even. So we should, I guess, say goodnight, and I will get information out. Do you guys have anything else final to say? Nope, okay.
Oh, exciting. Spring is coming.
Spring is coming, it's almost here. So I will talk to everybody later, and thank you for signing in. Okay, bye everyone.